eyes. My eyes go bad. It's tough. But his body is feasible. All this stuff is feasible to practice that. But we, you know, practicing in this video, it leads to what we're doing here. It leads to this realization. As far as structure, I don't have any structure. I don't exist in structure. I am. Where am I? No, just I am. It's not where am I, it's just I am. I say, I don't know where I am. I need it in the dream. I need it if I just said, ah, it's okay. It's okay. No, no, just I am. There is no where to I am-ness. Because I am is allness. Is isness. Is isness of allness, of eternal life. Just I am. I am. There's just this everywhere I am-ness. There's only I am. And the I amness is pure potential, which is eternal life, for all, always. Yeah. And again, go for the experiencing, the feeling, instead of the structuring. So that's why we're trying to make it really simple, just I am. That's it. And just put a little structuring and then reduce the structuring. A little structuring, reduce the structuring. I am, just I am. I am. There's only I am. Nothing is lost. Nothing is lost to eternal life. There's not any lostness anywhere, ever. No such situation whatsoever. There is no lostness at all. There's no separation at all. There's no lostness. See, children come in, they've experienced this before the structure of the body, you know, that this coalesces in some way. And that's why the child can just wander anywhere. They feel, wherever I am, all is, you know, all just is. They don't feel lost at all. And the parents say, oh my God, where did you go? You were lost. It's just, the child gets all freaked out. What are you talking about? I'm lost. And they say, no, no, this is your house. This is your parents. This is where you live. If you go anywhere else, you're lost. You don't know where you are. You got to stay, you know. The child doesn't understand this. Spirit doesn't understand this. I'm not trying to spiritualize the child. I'm just saying that the form, spirit is not yet identified with the form and structured enough, you know, to get into this lostness somewhat. So the form just, you know, it tends to just, we'll see children in church, little toddlers, and suddenly I'll see a little toddler just toddling down the aisle right there. That's very serious, you know, very serious mass. And the child is just running, running. Child's not lost. And after that, after a while, I say, I wonder how long it's going to be until the parent realizes they're running around. Suddenly, here comes this parent, you know, it's like, come here, find him. Come back, come back. Don't. They can't say anything, though. See, and it's very funny in church, they can't say anything. Whereas if not in church, they'd yell, hey, where are you? Get back here, you know. You can't run off like that. But they can't do that in church, so they like to go after very quietly after the child. You have to come, they grab his arm, you come back here. You pull it back, the child's like struggling. No, I want to run around. Come back here. You know, I've got to take you to the back and, you know, outside for a while. You know, so, but this is just a sort of a funny way of symbolizing it. But we here, we can realize just I am, I am. I am is not a loss. This is why you can do miracles anywhere. Miracles, there is nothing's lost. Nothing has to be found first at all. So literally you can manifest. This is the key to manifestation, really. I am is perfect everywhere. So if I want to manifest something, manifest right here. This is the key. Once we fully accept this, manifest anything at all. But it's not a thing. It is eternal life. So the realization that I am not lost, nothing is, not, when there is no lostness of I amness, then that the realization of our empowerment comes. We realize we've always been empowered. My gosh, we can manifest whatever we want right without having to go anywhere, find ourselves, or without anything needing to be rearranged anywhere, anything like that. No, all is eternal life right now, without any exception or exemption whatsoever. No thinking is necessary, no strategizing is necessary, no structuring is necessary for this to be so. It's inherently so. We need not take any thought to make it so. We need not take any thought to make it so. It is inherently so. Now maybe these videos are too much too much wow. Too much wow is possible for some. Too much wow. But getting used to it, maybe, settle down, calm down, settle down, calm down. So used to a lack of structuring, used to this lack of structure and say, not so. But you have to be disciplined at it. Use the will. Sometimes you have to use the will very strongly. Like imagine a sneeze building up. It's like it's hitting you like this, like super strong. But at that instant you decide, no, I'm not going to sneeze. You can use your will, and your attention focuses on your will. Poof! Instantly the sneeze, the urge to sneeze could vanish on you, just vanish. As I've been doing on videotape here, actually, when this occurs. But sometimes it does take a complete absorption of your attention to your will and realize I do have the power without any foolishness of saying, maybe I don't. I said, no, yes, I do. 100%, almost, as I said, 100%, yes, I do have the will and power over this. And as soon as you get that full, that I do have the power to not sneeze, boom, the urge to sneeze vanishes like that. So when you start to try to weave structure around this all, just use the will and say, yes, I do have 100% will. I will not try to weave any structure around this. I will not try to weave any structure at all. I'm just going to stay in this unstructured wowness. Now, I have to do this too. Yeah, as we all do. This is an invitation to practice together. Yeah, we all have to do the best we can with this. Certainly, you have to bring the will into play, because the mind is wanting to dance, dance some structure. Okay, you try to figure out, what is that dance that the mind is dancing, this structure? What is the structure it's dancing? Drop it. Take your attention off the dance. See, the mind wants to dance to get your attention, and says it's doing this, and you're trying to say, okay, I'm trying to figure out, what is it that the mind is getting at here? It's not getting at anything, it's just distracting you. Just drop the attention on whatever the story the mind's weaving. Drop it. There's no structure to reality. There's no story to reality. There's no story to it whatsoever. just the isness. And that is true. This is right now, the sense that there's no story whatsoever to anything. There is no story. It's just eternal life. Is all there is. There's no story to eternal life. It's just the absolute bliss of it. Eternal life doesn't have a need for a story in order to be what it is. Doesn't have need to, any need for determinate structure in order to be what it is. Here goes California throwing another awesome day at us. It's just, we just dropped that too. See, drop that story too. So drop the story of the awesome day also. The full awesome, the real awesomeness is right here, right now. Everything is eternal life right now. The nice California day is a story. A story we're telling ourselves, actually. But we don't even need that story at all. Neither need it, nor do we. It doesn't have to rise, doesn't have to not arise either. Neither one. Pure potential doesn't need anything to rise. It doesn't need anything to not arise. And our very nature is just to play with this pure potential, just to play with it, that's all. So, we do it the way, or as we were created, we have this inherent desire to play with pure potentiality, to experience. But pure potentiality doesn't have any desire on its own for anything to arise or not arise. Anything in particular, no. It's totally open to all arising and all non-arising equally. And it's understood in the creation that there will be a playing with this. Okay, to complete the creation, there's a playing with it. God created, quote-unquote, the Son of God, and to play with this pure potentiality. So we can't not play with it. You know, it's not possible for us to not play with it. But both manifesting and you know, abiding, arising, abiding, subsiding, you know, this is the play with it. Is actually formless. There is no determinant form at all. It's a play of essence. But this too is a play of essence, actually. It just doesn't, we just have defined it as if it isn't. At least we're getting some rain. That's great here. There's a feeling like the climate has shifted a little bit here. supposed to get some rain a couple days on Monday, and then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, supposed to be quite a bit of rain coming in. That's awesome. The more rain we get here in November and December, you know, the better option I hope we have for January, February, March, and April. It could even rain into May. The potential for a wet season is there, whereas if we didn't get anything in November or December, then we're going to start sweating bullets here, I'm telling you. But if we start really getting a lot of precipitation in now throughout December, you know, they say, wow, it's a possibility. You know, and then January starts also, then we say, wow, you know, at least it's not, you know, there's something happening here, it's great. Be a little less nervous about it. But drought is one of the great symbolic disempowerments in this planet. Famine, drought, two are usually correlated, right? What, the South Indian Ocean Oscillation, there's some, you know, that caused droughts in China and in India throughout history. Just the oscillation switches and the monsoons fail. And if that happens for like 3, 4, or 5 years in a row, you know, as it has, famine strikes and millions and millions and millions of people starve to death and succumb to all, and then cholera rages, smallpox rages, all these illnesses when your immune system is down, that becomes epidemic. This epidemic spreads everywhere. So you just have this colossal symbolic play of disempowerment taking place throughout history. Yeah. It's China and India and various populous places, there's been, you know, catastrophic famines due to the temperature oscillations of the oceans, and which causes the winds to not go in a certain direction and the monsoons don't come. So, this planet is really custom designed for symbolic disempowerment, absolutely. It's our baby, it's our child, we love it, you know? So you just have to love this child, say thank you, child, for showing up, this child we call the planet Earth. And thank you for giving us all these symbolic disempowerments, you know, that we needed so badly because we were so terrified we were going to be annihilated if we don't pretend like we're working on this. We don't really want to work on it, but we need to make God think that we really are working on this really strongly, you know? So thank you for showing up. Thank you, all the oceanic oscillations, the droughts, the famines, the pandemics, there, and also the wars that come from that, because, hey, there's no rain here. We better go to some place where they had rain and have food. So armies form. Migrations take place, you know, it's just the weather drives so much of everything on the planet, as throughout history. So we got this marvelous, unpredictable ocean. There's symbols of ocean of samsara, this very unpredictable ocean that can just creates havoc, continual havoc around the world. Will the rains come, you know? Or will the freeze be too severe and ruin our crops? Oh, we have nothing to eat. We need to go south. Go south and invade the southern areas where they have all these rich grains and the crops are pouring in and they got all the food. Well, we got to kill everybody there so we can survive, you know. And they say, stay away, stay away. So there's battles. So we have this wonderful world that is made us feel safe, a little bit safe, thinking that maybe God will think that we're really serious about finding disempowerment, even though we don't quite feel so serious about it. We're trying to be serious about it. Coming here in this world helps us focus in, try to be real serious about it. Now, I'm really serious about finding disempowerment here. And we help each other out. Can you help disempower me? And I'll help disempower you. Can you please help me out? I'll play the victim. You play the victimizer. And can you help me show the God that at least I'm working on being disempowered? And oh, thank you so much. You know, so thank you. love your enemy, Jesus said. And this whole world has been our enemy, you know. This whole situation is, it's causing us so much trouble. So I'll be aware that we're saying, please, would you please cause me all these problems, because at least I can, I don't want God to think that I'm a slacker, you know. But ultimately we're saying all of this is needed, you know, the war, the strife, the famines, you know, ultimately supernature, we can accept supernature, where there's none of that stuff, a realm where there's none of this play of disempowerment taking place at all, none of it, absolutely not taking place. And then we just say, wow, this is beautiful, wonderful, supernature, realm of supernature, death-free realms. They're waiting for us, you know, they're waiting for us. We're ready to set this world down, say, okay, don't thank you, love you, world, don't need you anymore. Because we're really loving our own creativity. Really loving ourselves when we love the world, and okay, loving our creativity, then bringing about this dreadful foe. If you look throughout history, you know, dreadful foe, you know. I mean, if it doesn't rain in California for another couple of years, there's going to be a lot of people who are kind of be bummed out, you know, towards Mother Nature, you know, pretty bummed out about it. Desert. Their beautiful paradise of life, hopes, you know, dashed by some dastardly ocean oscillation, temperature oscillation. Then they'll curse everybody. God, you caused a global warming. You caused this. You're the ones who caused this. You must pay for this, you know. It's a mess. The world's always a mess. That's what we want it for. That's what it's here for. It's created all sorts of problems. Bring us all sorts of problems, you know. Misery. Suffering. So, we can say, I'm not slacking, God. And I'm no slacker here. I'm doing what you told me to do. And of course, God did not tell us to do anything particular, not at all. This is all our fantasy. All our whim. It's all our whim. We just laugh at it. The whole situation. I'd laugh at the root of it. We're not laughing at the nastiness of it. We're forgiving that. We're loving it all. Forgiving it. And then laughing at the root of it. You know, lightening it up. Lighten the whole situation up. Lighten the whole situation up. When I was playing with that golfer first time, and I mean, I was like feeling like I'm going to just go into this morose, collapsed state, because I'm just embarrassing myself. It's just hideous. Everyone look at me like, what's the matter with him? I like take four swings at the ball and I miss it every time. You know, it's just like mortifying. But here's this other guy with me, his arm around me, saying, don't worry, everything'll be fine. You know, you'll get it. You're struggling, but you'll get better. Here he's just like awesome. And so people look at me, say, oh, he's a buddy friend of yours. Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, I'm just teaching him the game. Oh, okay, okay, okay. See, no problem. And so I didn't get too far down because he lightened everything up. I hit a terrible shot. He says, that's no problem. He hit a great one. I said, oh, that's beautiful. That's great. So to have those here in this world who lighten everything up like this is very helpful. It keeps us from getting too morose. It does. Sure, we're still floundering, but we don't get too morose. So I say it's very important in the world at this time to have those saviors, bodhisattvas, gurus, sages, etc., you know, that etc., etc., who lighten the whole thing up. See, everything's perfect, don't worry, you for us, so we don't get too depressed and morose, you know, get, otherwise, the world, the problems that we're throwing at ourselves right now are very severe, more severe than we may realize. We might say, hey, I don't think I want it quite this severe. Because we're really thinking of slack. And see, what happened in the 60s and 70s is we really started getting it, you know, enlightenment. And then there's a backlash, cosmic backlash. There's, you can't do that. You know, get back to work. God thinks you're slacking. Planet Earth's starting to slack here. This is terrible. Gee, Ramana Maharshi and Nandamayi and Punjaji and Nisargadatta Maharaj and various many others, you know, were here. And they taught us, hey, everything's perfect, you know, lighten up. And the cosmos said, my God, they're slacking on planet Earth. We got to send the stormtroopers in, cosmic crusaders, or cosmic crusading stormtroopers in, and get them back to work. Let's generate more problems here, my God. And so that's what's happened. So this really could be quite an avalanche of problems in this world now. But with those lighten us up, we'll say, oh, it's okay. Okay, I remember just, I said, my golfing friend here, yeah, that's over in some fairway. Oh, yeah, I'm playing with this guy over here. You know, he's doing great. They said, oh, really? Yeah. Yeah, he's like 300 par. Oh, wow, okay. It's like, yeah, I'm with him. And I'm just hacking it up horrible. Yeah, but I'm with him. Oh, okay. Yeah, you're legit. That's okay. Yeah, I get it. You're legit. So if you're with someone who's legit, you know, here's legit. It takes the pressure off of you. So I felt okay. I felt like I'm pretty cool. Even though I'm playing horrible, I'm still okay. I'm okay. I'm pretty cool. So it didn't really get me down too much, you see. And then I kept working on it. Didn't demoralize me. So if you're with some situation that's legit in this world, all the problems that we're manufacturing for ourselves, it won't get you down too bad. And then you'll say, you know what? I can probably get to the point where I realize I don't need any of these problems, actually. I think I can probably do that. So it is helpful. There is a way to help out in this world. It is a way to just, again, get used to less structure, just the wow. Just get used to it as much as possible. Don't let your mind throw a bunch of structure on it. So for me, I say, yeah, I'm with Jesus, or I'm with Longchenpa, I'm with Anandamayi, I'm with Ramana Maharshi. I'm legit, you know. I'm with someone who is legit. Okay. And it's true. So we don't get too demoralized during these times. It is important not to get too demoralized now. Very important, don't get too demoralized. Of course you're going to be demoralized to some extent, most of us will be, but don't get too demoralized. Just say, oh, I'm with someone who's legit, so I'm not going to get too down about all this. This has helped me through. Yeah, helped me through these last 50 years. I could have gotten completely demoralized. Because my God, I said, there's so many more problems coming. This is horrible. It's not getting better, it's getting more problems. But then I said, no, but I'm with these teachers and they know the answer to all this. So, I'm going to find out what the answer is too. So I'm not going to worry too much about it. So cling to the wowness. Just neutral, don't even cling to it, but just abide with it, just stay with it, just stay with the wow. This is wow, this is like super wow. This whole situation here is like a super wow, you know, it is super wow. Here's somebody here talking, and they're a friend of Jesus. They're a friend of Sri Sri Anandamayi, they're a friend of Ramana Maharshi, they're a friend of Longchenpa, you see. Someone's here is actually a friend of these, which is true, it's true, I am, absolutely. And here's somebody's talking in the world, it's like, wow. It's just wow, it's actually a big wow, super wow. This is only eternal life, all is eternal life right here. This is right now, this is it. It's wow. So, yeah, it's just a super wow. So just abide in this super wow, and you won't get so demoralized, I'm telling you. It's like an inoculation, a vaccination. It's like a vaccination. It's abide in a super wow, it's overall super wow, super wow. It may be a strain, sure, but it's also a vaccination to being demoralized by the world. When you abide in the super wow, you will not be demoralized. You will not be demoralized. Even though the whole world's falling apart around you, you won't be demoralized. necessarily like it. That's too bad. But you won't be fundamentally demoralized at all. No. And that's super important, especially the next 18 months, as I say, not to get demoralized. So hopefully I hope I can help out. I pray that I can be of assistance during the next, 18-month time in this world, where the potential for a lot of demoralization, especially the spiritual people on this planet who really, want to attune to truth, but they're not sure, what's the options? Well, the option is to abide in kind of this super wowness. Wow. I'm in this really super wow situation, and just abide in that, even though it may be difficult, but you won't be demoralized. You won't be so demoralized that you then continue on with another cycle of samsara, of conditioned existence, of buying into, I'm lost, where am I? I don't know who I am, where I am, what was, in searching for how can I disempower myself? You will not get caught up in that so bad at all. That is for sure. So, okay, let's see what happens next. Very great. That's it.